Congratulations on your decision to go to college. Another important decision you've made is to take out a federal student loan to help pay for your education. In this session, which federal law requires you to attend before your funds can be released, you will learn about your rights and responsibilities, and also your obligations as a borrower. Think of this session as being like an instruction manual on how your federal student loan, known as a direct loan, works. It probably won't all stick the first time you go through it, but you'll get a better understanding of how things work, and you can refer back to this as a resource in the future. This material is not intended to constitute any tax, investment, or legal advice. If you need investment, legal, tax advice, and/or credit counseling, please consult with a professional within those areas. Let's begin by saying that borrowing money is a serious matter. You have an obligation to repay the money that you borrow. Otherwise, there are some very negative consequences that can affect your life as you leave school. For example, if you default on your student loan, it negatively affects your credit report. Default occurs when you fail to make payments for 270 days. Also, when you apply for a job, potential employers may check your credit report before making you an offer. A negative report may prevent you from getting a job, which could mean you won't have an income to pay your bills. There are options available to help you manage your student loan debt and avoid default. Part of avoiding default is staying in contact with your financial aid office and loan servicer. Other consequences that you may experience as a result of not paying your loan include: your federal tax refund may be withheld as payment toward your defaulted loan. You may not be able to renew your professional license. A percentage of your wages may be withheld by your employer and sent to pay for your loan if you default. When you try to buy a car, a house, or rent an apartment, you may fail the credit check or get a much higher interest rate due to your negative credit history. If you decide to return to school for another degree, you will not be eligible for additional federal financial aid unless you resolve the default. You may be sued if you fail to repay your loan. Expensive collection fees can be added to your loan principal to help cover the collection costs on your defaulted loan, and debt collectors will be able to pursue repayment of your defaulted loan. However, if you do fall into default, you should know that the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, FDCPA, prohibits debt collectors from using abusive, unfair, or deceptive practices to collect from you. But regardless of those protections, it's still best to avoid the many negative consequences of default. Now let's review one of the most important documents for a direct loan, the Master Promissory Note, or MPN. Why is this document so important? Because unless you've signed it, you're not eligible to receive the money. The MPN is your written promise that you're going to repay the loan. It still counts as a written promise even if you sign it electronically, and you still have to repay the loan whether or not you complete the program or get your dream job. Depending on your school's policy, you may be able to use the same MPN to borrow multiple loans for up to 10 years, or you may need to sign a new one for each year in which you borrow a new student loan. This document contains specific details and terms about your loans, and you'll want to make sure you keep a copy. Please visit the link provided to get Texas A&M Kingsville policy and direct loan processing steps. Your MPN tells you what your interest rate is, how much you borrowed, and when you took out the loan. It will also say whether your loan is subsidized or unsubsidized, which can make a big difference in how much you might owe. Let's go through and look at these key differences of subsidized loans versus unsubsidized loans. Subsidized loans are need-based, and generally the government pays interest while you are in school, in grace, and during deferment periods for subsidized loans. Unsubsidized loans are not need-based. For unsubsidized loans, you're responsible for all interest accrued during all periods. Another important thing to know about direct subsidized loans is if you borrow your first loan on or after July 1, 2013, there are limits on how long you may receive direct subsidized loans. You cannot receive direct subsidized loans for more than 150% of the published length of your program. For instance, if your program length is 2 years, your maximum eligibility period is 3 years, which means you can receive subsidized loans for only 3 years while in the program. If your program length is 4 years, your maximum eligibility period is 6 years, which means you can receive subsidized loans for only 6 years while in the program. Your subsidized loan usage period is the period of time expressed in years or portions of years for which you have received a subsidized loan. The total of your subsidized loan usage periods is compared to the maximum eligibility period to determine if you are eligible for additional subsidized loans. If you continue to be enrolled in your program after you exceed your maximum eligibility period, you are no longer eligible to receive subsidized loans. However, if you need to borrow more money to complete your program, you can still get unsubsidized loans. Also, you must be aware that if you continue enrollment in that program after receiving 6 years of subsidized loans, or enroll in a shorter program at that point, you lose your interest benefits on the subsidized loans that you took out beginning on the date of your next enrollment. In other words, you become responsible for paying the interest on your subsidized loans even while you are in school, during your grace period, during periods of deferment, and for some income-driven repayment plans. How does accruing interest impact your total student debt? Well, capitalized interest increases your loan principal, increases your monthly payment amount under most direct loan repayment plans, and causes you to pay more interest over the life of your loan. Now let's take a look at how Texas A&M University at Kingsville determines the type of loans you get. This formula is used to determine your financial need. Depending on your financial need, the college will award you with either a subsidized or unsubsidized direct loan, or both. Your cost of attendance, or COA, is how much it will cost you to attend your school, including tuition and fees, housing costs, book supplies, transportation, and other miscellaneous expenses. Your expected family contribution, or EFC, is based on the information on your FAFSA. It's how much the government expects you and your family to contribute toward your education expenses over the school year. Texas A&M University at Kingsville looks at your COA and subtracts your EFC to determine your financial need. The financial aid office will do its best to award you with as much financial aid as you are eligible to receive in order to cover the cost of attendance. To get a subsidized loan, you will need to show financial need. Other need-based aid you receive may include grants, work study, and scholarships. Accepting a loan may affect your eligibility for other types of financial aid. Your total aid cannot be greater than your cost of attendance. That means that you will not be allowed to borrow an amount that puts you over your cost of attendance. There is a limit to how much you can borrow each year in direct loans. If you are an undergraduate student, you can borrow between $5,500 to $12,500 per year in direct subsidized loans and direct unsubsidized loans, depending on certain factors, including your year in college and whether you are dependent or independent for financial aid purposes. Dependent undergraduate students whose parents are unable to obtain PLUS loans may be eligible for larger annual loan limits. If you are a graduate student, you can borrow up to $20,500 each year in direct unsubsidized loans. The remainder of your college costs not covered by other financial aid can be covered by direct PLUS loans. Note that a credit check is required for a PLUS loan. There are also limits on how much you can borrow in direct loans overall. If you are dependent, you can borrow up to $31,000, and no more than $23,000 of that amount may be in subsidized loans. If you are an independent and an undergraduate, you can borrow up to $57,500, and no more than $23,000 of that amount may be in subsidized loans. If you are a graduate or professional student, you can borrow up to $138,500. No more than $65,500 of this amount may be in subsidized loans. The graduate aggregate limit includes all federal loans received for undergraduate study. So as long as you're planning your coursework, do everything you can to graduate on time, because you will run out of loan funding when you reach these limits. What about interest rates? Currently, the fixed interest rate for undergraduate direct subsidized and unsubsidized loans is 5.04%. The fixed interest rate for graduate direct unsubsidized loans is 6.59%. The interest rate will increase the amount you originally borrowed if you don't pay the interest while you are in college. You will also pay a relatively low fee, called the origination fee, based on the amount that you borrow, currently 1.066%. This fee helps offset the government's costs for administering the Federal Direct Loan Program. So make sure that you keep this fee in mind when you are budgeting for the school year. For example, if you borrowed $5,500, you will receive a little less because this fee will have been deducted. When does repayment begin? In most cases, repayment will begin after a 6-month grace period. Each loan has only 1 6-month grace period, and the grace period begins the day after you graduate, withdraw, or drop below half-time enrollment. Once the grace period has been used, it's gone, That means that if you were to use your grace period while taking a couple of semesters off, it's possible your loan will go directly into repayment when you graduate. At Texas A&M University, Kingsville, half-time enrollment for both undergraduates and graduates entails at least 6 hours each semester and 3 hours each summer session. What's a PLUS loan? The term often refers to loans parents use to help pay for their dependent children to attend undergraduate programs, but they're also an option for graduate and professional students. Direct PLUS loans also require a Master Promissory Note, or MPN, which, if you recall, is a binding legal agreement promising to repay your loan. It details a lot of specific information about your loans. In some cases, you may have to sign a new MPN each year, but some schools do allow a multi-year policy, in which the same MPN applies to multiple loans. Eligibility works differently for Student PLUS loans. There's not an annual limit or an aggregate limit, and the maximum amount you can borrow is determined by the school based on this calculation. Cost of attendance minus other estimated financial aid equals Student PLUS loan eligibility. Here's some more information on Student PLUS loans. Currently, the origination fee is 4.264% with a 7.59% fixed interest rate, which begins to accrue right away. Repayment of PLUS loans technically begins once you get all the money upon final disbursement. However, these loans have some flexible benefits, one of which is that you don't have to actually begin making payments until 6 months after graduating, withdrawing, or dropping below half-time status, because your loan will be placed on an in-school deferment. You can also prepay all or part of the loan with no penalty. Prepayments of principal may substantially reduce future interest costs. Making payments while still in school can reduce future payments. It's important to keep in mind that the amount you are allowed to borrow can only be used to cover education-related expenses, which include tuition and fees, room and board, books, supplies, transportation, and other expenses that are part of your school's cost of attendance. A good way of thinking about whether an expense is education-related is to apply the need versus wants rule. For example, you might think that you need a car to get to school. However, a car is not something you need if you have other options for transportation, like using public transportation. Again, you want to borrow only what is needed and necessary. Loans are released in multiple disbursements. Typically, that means you receive one disbursement at the beginning of the enrollment period and another at the midpoint. For example, if you're enrolled in the fall and spring semesters, you'll receive a disbursement at the beginning of the fall term and again at the beginning of the spring term. If you happen to enroll in only one term in a school year, you'll generally receive a disbursement at the beginning and another halfway through the term. As you develop your budget, you should account for only the amount you will get in a particular term versus thinking that you will receive your full loan amount at once. Now let's think ahead and talk about repayment. Repayment may seem like it's far into the future, but that reality will arrive. Borrowing to pay for school is a serious matter that can negatively impact your life if you don't repay the money. However, there are a number of repayment options that are available to you. There are different repayment plans, and you can choose which plan best suits your situation. Also, you can change repayment plans. There are certain repayment plans, standard or graduated, that may allow you to pay off your loan sooner, saving you interest over the life of the loan. Other repayment plans, for example, graduated and extended, may allow you to have smaller payments when you're experiencing difficulty in repayment. There are flexible, income-driven repayment plans that take into account your income, family size, and student loan debt. Note, however, that such plans may cause you to pay a higher total amount when the loan is paid in full. The important thing to remember is that the federal loan program offers multiple options to pay back your loans. In your exit counseling session, you will learn more about each of these options. Things in life can go off course sometimes. What if, once you're in repayment, you don't get your billing statement because it got lost in the mail or ended up in your email junk folder, or you can't find a job, or you're not happy with the school or its services, or you didn't graduate on time? Or what about any other number of problematic what ifs? What then? The bottom line is, you're still responsible to work out an arrangement by which you can repay your loan, even if you don't find a job. Keeping in communication with your loan servicer is your key to repayment success. Consider an alternative repayment plan as a first option when things are tough. Once you've researched the various plans, if you find that none of them work for you, you may want to consider two other options: deferment and forbearance. Deferment allows you to postpone payments under certain circumstances, such as returning to school, unemployment, or military service. The government pays the interest that accrues on subsidized loans during a deferment. A forbearance is generally a more costly option, and is often a last resort, because with forbearance, the federal government does not pay the interest on your loans. Make sure you ask for a deferment first, since it's a better option. Whether you're a direct loan or PLUS loan borrower, while you're in school, in many cases, interest accrues on your loan. When entering repayment, that unpaid interest is added to the balance, and the amount you owe can suddenly be a lot more. This is called capitalization. Interest also capitalizes when a deferment or forbearance ends. Because of interest capitalization, it could benefit you to prepay additional principal whenever possible. Interest may be capitalized following in-school deferment for Student PLUS loans. Here's an example of how this might work. For an unsubsidized direct loan, interest equals principal, multiplied by rate, and multiplied by time. $5,500 multiplied by 0.0376 multiplied by 5.5 years equals $1,137. This interest capitalization occurred after it took the student 5 years to graduate, plus the 6-month grace period. In this case, 5.5 years transpired before the student entered repayment. Keep track of your student loans through the National Student Loan Data System for Students. Go to the nslds.ed.gov to see a listing of all your federal student loans. You will need a FAFSA ID to access the site, the same as you use to log on to complete the FAFSA. If you don't have or remember your FSA ID, you can get help at www.studentaid.ed.gov. Also, if you withdraw, remember to follow your college's formal withdrawal procedures. Make sure to notify the financial aid office, your academic advisor, and registrar's office of your withdrawal. Withdrawing will trigger your loan to go into grace period and repayment. Finally, complete exit counseling before you withdraw, graduate, or drop below halftime. Exit counseling is also a federal requirement and will serve to refresh your memory about your rights and responsibilities as you enter repayment. Remember that for halftime enrollment, students need at least 6 hours during the long semester, and students also need at least 3 hours during summer. Please take a minute to complete the survey below.